This is the second part of the video lectures on elasticity, and we're going to go ahead and go beyond just the definition of elasticity to start thinking about what does elasticity mean? Where does it come from? And one way of thinking about it is that elasticity is related to the slope of the demand curve. Roughly, all else equal here, if the demand curve is steep, that means that price changes cause small changes in quantity demanded, which is another way of saying that buyers are not price sensitive. And you might go further and say quantity demanded is relatively inflexible. When price changes, not much happens with quantity demanded. And if something's inflexible, another way you might think about this is that it's inelastic. So economists often talk about some goods being inelastically demanded. That means that when price goes up, people only reduce their purchases a little bit. In technical terms, elasticity is between 0 and negative 1. And you can see that I made a mistake here with one of my inequality signs. Or for authors and textbooks who prefer to talk about the absolute value of elasticity, the absolute value of elasticity is between 0 and 1. Again, thinking back to that definition of elasticity, if we have a definition, if we have an elasticity that's something like negative 0.25, that means that if you raise prices by 1%, quantity demanded will fall by 0.25%. So you can see how that's a fairly small price change. On the other hand, when the demand curve is pretty flat, even relatively small price changes cause large changes in quantity demanded, which is another way of saying that buyers are very price sensitive, or that quantity demanded is flexible. And if something's flexible, it's elastic. So economists often talk about demand being elastic when it responds very strongly to price changes, or when the demand curve is pretty flat. On a technical level, you could say that elasticity is less than negative 1, so elasticity is something like negative 5. Or the absolute value of elasticity is greater than 1. And remember that if elasticity is something like negative 5, that's saying that when you raise your prices by 1%, quantity demanded falls by something like 5%. So that's a pretty strong response. Now, all that said, elasticity isn't quite the same thing as slope. One way of noticing this is the slope of the demand curve would be measured in money relative to physical units. And because of that, the slope of the demand curve would change if we change the currency unit or if we change the physical unit. Also, we would expect the slope of the demand curve to be different in a large market from a small market. Elasticity is measured in percentage terms, and the reason why we measure it in percentage terms is to get around these two problems up here. So, elasticity is relatively unlikely to change if we're changing currency units or units of measurement. And also, elasticity is less likely to change as we change market size. It gives us a good way to talk about the price sensitivity of demand for a good in different markets, regardless of their size. Another thing to notice here that makes elasticity different from slope is that elasticity actually is different at different points, even along a linear demand curve that has the same slope everywhere. And to see that, let's think about a simple demand curve where quantity demanded is 101 minus price. So that if price is 0, quantity demanded is 101. If price is 1, quantity demanded is 100. If price is 2, quantity demanded is 99, and so on. So, with that demand curve, think about what elasticity is as price goes from $1 to $2. And notice quantity demanded at $1 is 100, quantity demanded at $2 is 99. So those are your beginning and ending values of price. So that's at the bottom end of the demand curve. At the top end of the demand curve, what is the elasticity as the price goes from $99 to $100? And you want to go ahead and notice that if price is $99, quantity demanded is 2. If price rises up to $100, quantity demanded falls to 1. So you'll be able to work through those examples. If you work through those examples, you'll get some actual numbers, and those numbers should indicate that at the top end of the curve, we're going to go ahead and see that although a $1 price change is only a small percentage change, it's going to produce a very large change in quantity. At the bottom end of the demand curve, when prices are already low, a $1 reduction in price is a really large percentage change in price. But as it says here, given that we have lots and lots of units already being sold, even if we gain the same number of units from the $1 price reduction, it's a smaller percentage change in quantity. And all this actually should make intuitive sense. When we're charging really high prices, the product is beyond most people's reach. And as we cut the price, we can pretty rapidly expand the number of people who will want to buy the product. But at the bottom end of the curve, when prices are already very low, most people probably buy as much of the product as they want. They're probably pretty close to being satiated with the product. And it's probably hard to get them to increase their purchases with further price reductions. So at the top end of the demand curve, we think that people are price sensitive, and at the bottom of the demand curve, we think that people are not price sensitive. And that exactly corresponds to price sensitive is elastic, and not price sensitive is inelastic. So, besides different current levels of prices, why is the demand for some goods more elastic or less elastic than others? And there's a pretty short list here, and some of the things on this list are even redundant, so it could probably be made even shorter. But what we're going to see there is that any of the following will tend to make demand more elastic. If a good has lots of good substitutes available, when people start to raise their prices, consumers will switch to the substitutes and they'll drop off from buying the good that had the price increase pretty quickly. So that will tend to make quantity demanded very responsive to a price change. Usually, when consumers have a longer time frame, they're more willing and able to change their habits and take advantage of a good that has become cheaper, or go away from a good that has become more expensive. And sort of a classic example you might look at here is the demand for something like natural gas as electricity prices change. So a lot of people, for instance, have a choice between a gas dryer for clothes and an electric dryer for clothes. If prices change, nobody's going to go out and instantly buy a new dryer to take advantage of the change in price between natural gas and electricity. But over time, people's dryers will naturally wear out and they'll tend to go ahead and take advantage of the price changes. The same sort of thing applies with cars. If gas prices go up, people aren't going to instantly go out and sell their SUVs and buy more fuel-efficient vehicles. But if gas prices go up and stay up for a long time, then again, when people come around to replacing their vehicle, they're going to take those higher gas prices into account, and so they're more likely to respond to the price change than they would and the extreme short run. Now, I've said usually here because there are some goods where people are willing to temporarily change their buying habits when prices change, but in the longer run, they're pretty fixed. So, for instance, we might see that if house prices are down in a particular year or up in a particular year, people don't respond very strongly because they go ahead and think, I'm going to go ahead and buy a house at some point here anyway. And this is a long-term decision. Another way of looking at this is how narrow is the definition of the product or the market. And when we have a narrowly defined product, a very sort of specific definition of a product, that's equivalent to saying there are lots of good substitutes. So effectively, number three is basically another version of number one. Luxury goods are goods that people don't feel they absolutely need. And so when the price of a luxury good goes up, people cut back on their purchases much faster than they do on necessities. When things are a large part of the budget, a price change quickly makes it very difficult to actually even afford the increased price. And so when things are a large part of the budget, people tend to respond more rapidly to price changes than otherwise. And we have an example question here that is addressed to one of these criteria, and I'll let you go ahead and work through that.